Ladies and gentlemen, would you please stand? Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to you all as we unite here together this afternoon in love, in friendship, and in remembrance for the life of the beautiful Anne Vine. My name's Amy, and it's an honour for me to stand here beside you all today. Today is a day for memories and will be remembered for many reasons. But mainly I hope that given time, it can be remembered by you all as a very special day. A special day in which you shared some time with others in order to pay your last respects and to say a sad but fond farewell to Anne. a truly wonderful lady whom you were all so privileged to have known. I sincerely hope that in time you can all be comforted to some degree by this last important act of love and respect that we shall all share here today. Whilst we are here to celebrate and to give thanks for Anne's life, it's also extremely important for us as humans to acknowledge our grief and the immense gap that her passing has left in all of your lives. Therefore, at this time and throughout this service, please do feel free to allow your tears and sadness to flow as we now begin to change our relationship with Anne from one of physical presence to one of memory. Now, Anne's passing has left such a void in your lives, but we must remember her loving ways, her beautiful smile, her kindness, the good deeds she did, the happy moments, the good memories, and the laughs that you've all had with her over the years. And when you remember these, you must smile and remember the love that she had for each and every one of you. Now, there's one thing we can all be certain of today, and that is that Anne would not want to be remembered with sadness, but rather with thoughts of the good times, the happy moments, and the special memories of her life, and perhaps even at times with a laugh or two. If I had a voice today, I'd say, dear ones, please don't cry. Still love me, but don't grieve for me. It's easy if you try. Don't think of all that I won't see. Just think of what I have seen. Think not of places I won't go, but remember where I've been. I've lived, I've loved, I've laughed and I've cried. I've worked hard, that's for sure. I've done my best, I'm satisfied. I couldn't ask for more. I know not what becomes of me, nor what's beyond today. If I had a choice, I'd use my voice, but alas, I've gone away. You have so many memories of me to enjoy, so smile, laugh and be tough. You have loved me and enriched my life. I was happy, and that's enough. I'm going to hand you over to Alan now, who has a beautiful tribute to Anne to share with us this afternoon. Thank you, Alan.
I know Anne is looking down on me at this moment in time, probably laughing her head off, because here I am in a blue suit and a bloody Chelsea scarf wrapped around my neck. As Amy said, Anne was a very fun, happy person, and she wouldn't want any of us to be sad. So that being the case, I'm going to take a light-hearted view of Anne's life, as well as talk about some of her characteristics and habits that I've gleaned from anecdotes that she's passed down to me directly, and also from her friends and family. If I use them all, we'd be here until midnight. So I'd encourage you, when we get back to the golf club afterwards, to share some of those wonderful memories that you have of Anne with each other. Anne was born and raised in a council estate in East Sheen called the Willoughbys. She had a loving mum, Ruth, and they were very similar. They were both beautiful, both little, and both could be very feisty when they wanted to be. She had a wonderful father as well, Harry. She absolutely doted on her dad. She was a real daddy's girl. Anne was one of four siblings. So Linda, Graham, who sadly passed away a few years back, and little David, I call him. But Linda left for Africa when Anne was growing up. So she had to learn to fight a little bit dirty to compete with her brothers. And while she loved her older brother, Graham, they could wind each other up. And if Graham did annoy her, she wouldn't think twice about going around stamping on his Sabutio players. But she wasn't daft. She wouldn't hang around for too long, and she'd go and lock herself in the bathroom before Graham could get hold of her. When Davy came along, Anne really had her nose put out of joint. She loved being the baby of the family, and all of a sudden there was this new young upstart in her place. So she started plotting her revenge from quite a young age. Anne would pretend to jump off the balcony, and secretly she'd be hiding behind the curtains, leaving poor old Dave in floods of tears. It wasn't unknown as well, on a particular trip to Windsor Safari Park, for Anne to take Dave and leave him somewhere, and then just tell everyone that she didn't know where he was. Though their bond did increase a little bit, On one particular occasion, Dave was getting a bit of a beating in the school playground. So Anne rushed to his rescue, grabbed the other girl by the hair, swung her around and basically said to her, "Boy, that's my job." As far as I'm aware, though I'm sure some people here will probably say different, Anne's school life was a little bit uneventful in the fact that she left with no qualifications, but it didn't actually hinder her in her careers. But one fact did amaze me is that Anne won the district hurdles. And I've never fathomed that, considering Anne was about that tall and the hurdles were about the same height. So I still don't know if she went under them or over them. After Anne left school, her first job was in banking. You could regularly see Anne at Barnes Station. She was being lifted onto the train by random young men. It seems like tight pencil skirts, little legs and high heels are not conducive to getting on trains. But banking life didn't suit Anne. She got pulled in by a manager one day who basically told her she should be barefoot, fancy free and pregnant by now. That was a red rag to a bull to our little Anne. So to get her own back, she turned up the next day with a boob tube, hot pants and high heels. I don't think a lot of work got done that day. Anne's had many jobs in her life, from owning her own wine bar, being a bunny girl at the International Playboy Club. She turned down Page Three. She worked as a croupier in some high-class casinos. And latter life, she spent a lot of time working in HR and recruitment with many blue-chip companies. But she also worked in currency exchange as well, on the cruise ships and at the airport. And for those that know Anne and the Vine family well, you know they do have a love of flatulence. Coming to that. She always told me that she had to learn to compete with her brothers. Sorry, boys, no competition. On this particular occasion, working at the airport in a porter cabin with one of her best friends, Jane, Anne obviously felt the urge to go. And whilst Jane was busy serving, Anne quietly went round, shutting the windows, relieved herself, locked the door, and walked round the front just to watch Jane turn varying shades of green, gagging for air. I'd love to say she improved with later life, but she didn't. Anne was an adventurous type. She had an adventurous spirit and she'd give anything a go. From scuba diving, surfing, go aping with my kids, skiing. She even did a parachute jump once for Great Ormond Street Hospital. Everyone else jumped out the plane and aimed for the big white marker in the field. Not our Anne, she went the opposite way, landed 70 foot up in the air in a tree. And it took a couple of hours for the firefighters to cut her down. And all she got for her endeavours was a bruised boob and a cuddle from Jimmy Savile. Everyone knows that Anne absolutely adored children. Not. She thought they were vile creatures. The irony was not lost on our friends and family when we got together and she inherited my three buggers. She loved them to pieces. She was a wonderful stepmum and they thought the world of her. She taught them well. She taught them the best thing about a roast beef dinner, much to their mother's horror, was to take a piece of white bread and dunk it in the beef dripping. And it was always a punch-up when it came to that time, usually with Anne winning to get to the front. Though she clearly loved them, because she allowed them to nick the glacier cherries out of her Prosecco glass. And it also cost me a fortune in manicured nails, as the kids wore her fingers out with back tickles and head scratches. However, what did amaze me is that her two best mates, Jill and Teresa, entrusted Anne with babysitting duties for her kids. Anne's probably only changed a nappy twice in her life, and even then I think someone else did it and she took the claim. With Jill's two, Lisa and Alex, if they misbehaved, she threatened with locking them in the attic, which is a ploy I believe Lisa still uses of her own today. Though, to be fair, I think Teresa's two boys, Joe and Tom, fared a lot worse. Anne would regularly send them home with plaques in their hair. And Anne also took great pride telling Teresa that she had actually washed them, but in reality she'd let the dog pin them down and lick them to death. My own kids also gave Anne the greatest respect as well. especially after she told them the story of standing at the bottom of the stairs and whacking her ex-husband round the head with a frying pan. I have to say, we were all a little bit nervous if we ever saw Anne walking around with a pan in her hand. Another virtue that Anne had was she was known for her great patience, i.e. she didn't have any. If we ever pulled up at a red traffic light and there was a car in front, to Anne, that was a traffic jam, and it had to be avoided at all cost. And one of two things would happen. Either we'd take a 3-mile detour, because in theory it was quicker, or 99 times out of 100, she'd race off like a bat out of hell and beat any boy racer standing. Keith, that's thanks to your driving skills, mate. And it was always followed up by, whilst I was peeling myself off the back windscreen, Anne would always follow it up with the customary victory cry of, yes, done it. My kids also learnt some new language as well when Anne was in the car. Anne was known for her OCD tendencies. And as a lot of people know, in our home, the sanctuary in our home is our kitchen. We just love spending time in there. We'd put the world to rights in there, always with a glass of wine in hand, music on. We would sing, we would dance, we would cuddle, we'd snog. I'll stop there. And we would cook. Though I'd never let Anne near anything sharp, primarily because I didn't want fingers in my dinner. So whilst I would do all the chopping, Anne was the food stirrer and the chief taster. However, as a sous chef, she was a bloody nightmare. If you put your knife down for 2 seconds, I'll guarantee it would have disappeared. She had washed it, dried it, and put it back away, whilst I'd spent the next 10 minutes walking around the bloody kitchen looking for the thing. But this tendency also went to other things as well. The curtains had to be drawn so there was no gaps. The beds had to be made in a particular way. Pillows had to be plumped up in a particular way. And towels had to be hung at the same length. But her OCD stretched further than that. It also stretched to her own positions. Possessions, get it right. It was a standing joke between her mates and I that Anne would always have everything that she owned, like her watches, her handbags, her shoes, in a box, in a bag, in a box. Thankfully, Anne didn't have anything to do with the funeral arrangements today, because I'm sure if she did, that coffin would have a few more layers on it as well. Anne loved the outdoors. She loved the wind in her hair, and we would often be seen walking hand in hand throughout the surrounding countryside where we live, especially the Surrey Hills, which was our favourite spot. I think we're both tree huggers at heart. Though Anne's greatest love was the sea. You couldn't keep her out of it. I've been told many a time the only way she was enticed out of the water was to give her fruit and nut. She was the same in later life, though it was something a little bit stronger, usually Prosecco. Anne loved animals much more so than humans. She was the infamous Surrey catnapper. There isn't a cat within a 1-mile radius that hasn't been kidnapped at some stage. Though her biggest love were her dogs. She loved Doggy, Boise and Sunny to pieces. And regularly when I'd go walking with her, I'd turn around and find out I'd been talking to myself for the last 5 minutes as Anne was about 200 yards behind me getting a dog fix. Anne was a stunningly beautiful woman. She could turn every man's head and light up the room with a radiant smile. Not only was she physically beautiful, she was beautiful inside as well. She had a heart of gold and would do anything for her family and friends. She had an amazing sense of humour. She was always up for a giggle and a laugh and was very quick-witted. Though it has to be said, she was never politically correct. Anne was my soulmate, my best friend, my lover, my rock, my everything, and I miss her so much. Anne lived a full life, and I'm so grateful that I've been able to share part of that life, as I'm sure many people in this room would feel the same. We had a wonderful life together, we enjoyed the simple things and the finer things in life, and we were very fortunate to be able to travel the world. We just loved being in each other's company. Anne's life was cruelly cut short, and we should have had many more years in front of us. But as someone once said, a life is not measured by the years you live, but by the love you gave and the things you did. Anne was an amazing person and touched so many people. Until we meet again, darling, you fly high and you shine bright. Ta-ta.
Thank you so much, Alan, for those beautiful words. And now Erin's going to share a poem with us. Thank you, Erin.
Remember me. Speak of me as you have always done. Remember the good times, laughter and fun. Share the happy memories we've made. Do not let them wither or fade. I'll be with you in the summer sun. And when the winter's chill has come, I'll be the voice that whispers in the breeze. I'm peaceful now, put your mind at ease. I've rested my eyes and gone to sleep. But memories we've shared are yours to keep. Sometimes our final days may be a test, but remember me when I was at my best. And although things may not be the same, don't be afraid to use my name. Let your sorrow last for just a while. Comfort each other and try to smile. I've lived a life filled with joy and fun. Live on now and make me proud of what you'll become.
Thank you, Erin. Ladies and gentlemen, we take a moment of reflection now to gather our thoughts and remember Anne in our own way as we listen to some music and see some photographs from her life.
We were just kids when we fell.
Some beautiful photos there. Thank you, Alan. Family and friends, the time has now come for us to say our final farewell to Anne. We are so very grateful for the life that Anne has lived and for all that her life has meant to us. We cherish the memories of her works, of her deeds and of her character. We cherish her friendship, and most of all, we cherish her love. We now leave the memory of our beloved Anne in peace. With enduring love and respect, we bid her farewell. If you are able, would you please stand? Thank you. Please be seated. We have been remembering today with love and gratitude a life that was important and honouring life itself. What can I do to mark this moment, you may ask? Well, you can help, support and love those who remain. You can allow them to cry, to grieve, to laugh and to remember. Grief takes its own time to work itself through, but it's so much easier with family and friends who allow it to be what it needs to be. You can honour your own feelings, maybe today, maybe in 6 months' time, and you can bless each day that you live and live it to the full in honour of life itself and, of course, in honour of our beloved Anne. I'm afraid we all do take life so very much for granted, but it really is the greatest gift that we have. For Anne, this new journey is just beginning, but for all of us here, there is loss, grief and pain. Every one of us here in this room today has had our lives touched, perhaps in the tiniest way, or perhaps totally transformed by Anne's existence. We wouldn't be here together otherwise. We take a moment now to listen to a special piece of music, one of Anne and Alan's songs.
Why'd you smile while you are sleeping?
Anne's passing makes us see the most precious gift that we have, the gift of love. And when we lose someone that we love deeply, we do feel pain like no other. It's the tears of love that flow the longest, the pain of love that aches the deepest, and the thoughts of love that move us the most. In the name of your loved one, whatever it was that you called her, that's a special and a magical word. So you must speak it, think it, and remember it. Anne lived in your hearts and minds, and in your hearts and minds, Anne will continue to live. When we are weary and in need of strength, when we are lost and sick at heart, when we have joys we yearn to share, we will remember Anne. And as long as we live, Anne too shall live, for she is a part of all that have known and loved her. So may you find richness and example in your memories of her. May you find strength and support in your love of one another. And may you find peace in your hearts. I'd like to thank you all so very much for being here today to remember and to celebrate Anne's life. And I do hope that as we shortly prepare to leave this place, that each of you can do so safe in the knowledge that Anne is at peace. And please do share some more wonderful memories of this truly beautiful lady together this afternoon. I wish you all love, strength and courage moving forward. Please do take very good care of yourselves and of each other. In a moment, when our last piece of music plays, could I please ask that you all follow myself and our funeral director outside, as the family would like a moment alone with Anne to say their final goodbyes. Thank you. It was beautiful, as long as it lasted, the journey of my life. I have no regrets whatsoever. The pain I'll leave behind, those dear hearts who love and care, and the heavy with sleep ever moist eyes. A smile in spite of a lump in the throat and the strings pulling at the heart and soul. The strong arms that held me up when my own strength let me down. Each morsel that I was fed was full with love divine. At every turning of my life, I came across my loving family and good friends. Family and friends who stood by me even as time raced by. Farewell, my loved ones, farewell. I smile and bid you goodbye. No, shed no tears, for I need them not. All I need is your smile. If you feel sad, think of me, for that's what I'd like. When you live in the hearts of those you love, remember then you never die.
Thank you.